So hello, this is Father Larry Delaney. Last night we had our Afterlife and Salvation seminar, and we had troubles with the broadcasting and the recording. So I'm going to do the session again. I'm in Sean Erickson's office and just going to go through the session again. Obviously, there won't be interaction back and forth, and so just do straightforward with the presentation. Let's begin in prayer. In the name of Father, Son, Holy Spirit, amen. And Lord God, we know that you have promised the gift of life eternal, and we want to share in that life together. And also, we want those that we have loved who have died to be one with you in heaven. So please hear our prayers, our desires, and prepare us to be welcomed by you into eternal life. We ask this through Christ our Lord, in the name of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Now I'm going to share a screen. And so this PowerPoint that I put together, right here, okay. PowerPoint that I put together. Oh, okay, there we go. There we go. There we go. Now we're set to go. So this back, if you remember back whenever we did the Renew program that went with the Catechism, during those years that we were doing that Renew program, every week, people wanted to delve into the Catechism on a more academic level. So every week I prepared a PowerPoint presentation on the various paragraphs that were being dealt with in that week. So through those 4 years, I think I put together 42 PowerPoint presentations on the various aspects of the Catechism. So much of this stuff that we're going through today is coming from those PowerPoint presentations. So the sections of the Catechism that I'll be using today is, first of all, in the first section of the Catechism is the Profession of Faith, where it goes through the Creed and each line of the Creed. So one of the sections that will be dealt with today is the I Believe in the Forgiveness of Sins, paragraphs 796 to or 976 through 987. Later is the line of I Believe in the Resurrection, the Body, and Life Everlasting. Those paragraphs are 988 to 1065. And then also be taking a little bit from the third section of the Catechism on Sacraments, be dealing with the section on indulgences. That's 1471 to 1479. So those three sections compose much of what we will go through today. So we begin with, I believe in the resurrection of the body. We hear from St. Paul in Romans, if the spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ Jesus from the dead will give life to your mortal bodies also through his spirit who dwells in you. So a promise of the resurrection for our own resurrection. Belief in the resurrection of the body and soul has been an essential part of Christian beliefs from the beginning. How can, St. Paul says, how can some of you say that there is no resurrection of the dead? If there is no resurrection of the dead, then Christ has not been raised. If Christ has not been raised, then our preaching is in vain and your faith is in vain. But in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. The belief in the resurrection was gradually revealed through time. So, at the time of Moses, they didn't have an understanding of the resurrection, but by the time it comes to Christ Jesus, there's a more fuller understanding of the resurrection. So it was gradually revealed throughout the ages. Going to 2 Maccabees, which is 2 Maccabees is talking about a time when Jewish people were revolting against the Greeks who had conquered the Holy Land. And we'll get to another passage later from Maccabees, but this is about 180 years before the birth of Christ. In 2 Maccabees, it says, "The King of the universe will raise us up to an everlasting renewal of life because we have died for his laws. One cannot but choose to die at the hands of men and to cherish the hope that God gives of being raised again by him." So they believed that even if they died at the hands of man, they could be raised by God. The Pharisees, you know, they had two kind of major groups of teaching in the Jewish community at the time of Jesus, the Pharisees and the Sadducees. The Pharisees were a group that believed in the resurrection, and they hoped for the resurrection. Jesus links faith in the resurrection to his own person, saying, "I am the resurrection and the life." To be a witness to Christ is to be a witness to his resurrection. So the two were intricately entwined together. From the Gospel of John, Jesus says, "It is the will of him who sent me that I should lose nothing of what he has given me, rather that I should raise it up on the last day. Indeed, this is the will of my Father, that everyone who looks upon the Son and believes in him shall have eternal life. Him I will raise on the last day." So Jesus giving us the promise of the resurrection. What is the what, who, how, and when of the resurrection? The what. The resurrection is the resurrection of the body and soul rejoined together through the power of Jesus' own resurrection. Who is resurrected? All are resurrected. Some to the resurrection of life with God in heaven, others to the resurrection of judgment. How will this happen? In Jesus, he will change our lowly body to be like his own glorious body. Those words that I just said are words that are spoken at every funeral as a part of the prayer, realizing that our lowly body will be changed. It will be a resurrected body like Christ's own body or resurrected body. But someone will ask, says Jesus, "How are the dead raised? With what kind of body do they come? You foolish man, what you sow does not come to life unless it dies. And what you sow is not the body which is to be, but the bare kernel. What is sown is perishable, but is raised is imperishable. The dead will be raised imperishable, for this perishable nature must put on the imperishable, and this mortal nature must put on immortality." So our resurrected body is not our the physical body that we have on earth, but it's the resurrected body. The how exceeds our imagination. We can only imagine that with our faith, that it isn't a scientific process that we can explain that way, but through faith we believe that we will be resurrected. When will this happen? On the last day, Christ's parousia. In part we participate in resurrection in our earthly life. So in baptism, we talked about how we died with Christ in our baptism. and we will also be raised with him through faith. Respect for the body, then. We have respect for the body because it is a participation already in the resurrection of Christ, of ourselves and of Christ. Dying with Christ. To rise with Christ, we must also die with Christ. And we must be away from the body and at home with the Lord. Our death is a participation in the death of the Lord's, so that we can rise with him. If we're going to rise with him, we first must also die with him. Death is the end of our earthly life. But keep in mind, you know, our life began with conception, and then we were born, and then we were baptized into new life in Christ, and lived our earthly life. But that timeline of our total existence with God does not end with physical death. It continues on a journey beyond our physical death. Death, we know, is the consequence of sin. When Adam and Eve entered into sin, the result was death was possible because of the result of our sin. But death is transformed by Christ into a blessing. Our physical death, when we die in Christ's grace, completes our dying with him in baptism and completes our incorporation into him in his redeeming act. Just a reminder, you know, part of Christian theology, there is no reincarnation. We don't come back alive in another form. That's a Hindu and Buddhist theology. We believe as Christians that we have a single earthly life. The Christian views death as a step towards everlasting life. So continuing on that continuum of our total existence. Prayer put up here, I just love this prayer. Whenever we give somebody viaticum, that's communion for the last time. Viaticum translated means food for the journey. This is the prayer that we say with them. And just look at this prayer and listen to it, and you can see that path of going towards God in heaven. Go forth, Christian soul, from this world, in the name of God the Almighty Father, who created you, in the name of Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God, who suffered for you. Go forth, faithful Christian. May you live in peace this day. May your home be with God in Zion, with Mary, the Virgin Mother of God, with Joseph and all of the angels and saints. May you return to your Creator, who formed you from the dust of the earth. May Holy Mary, the angels, and all the saints come to meet you as you go forth from this life. May you see your Redeemer face to face. So it's acknowledging that the end of earthly life is taking place, but it is not the end of life. It's that they are now moving on to be dwelling with God in eternal life and with Mary and all the saints and angels. At the end of our earthly life, death puts an end to our human life as a time open either to accepting or rejecting the divine grace manifested in Christ. And at that point, each of us receives our eternal retribution in his immortal soul at the moment of death. And so that at that time of death, it's either thumbs up or thumbs down. But it's that we get that particular judgment at that moment. Those who die in God's grace and friendship are perfectly purified and are perfectly purified, live forever with Christ, and they see him as he is, face to face. So the perfectly purified, those that are perfectly purified at the moment of death, go to heaven before the general judgment. These souls can see the divine essence with intuitive vision and even face to face without mediation of any creature. So those that have been declared saints, who believe that they died in a perfectly purified state, so like St. John Paul II, St. Mother Teresa, that they, at their particular judgment, at the moment of death, they were perfectly purified, so they dwell with God in heaven. Heaven is the perfect life with the Most Holy Trinity, the communion of life and love, the Virgin Mary, the angels, and the other blessed, the other saints. By death and resurrection, by his death and resurrection, Jesus opened the gates to eternal life in heaven. The mystery of blessed communion with God and blessed is beyond all understanding and description. So, you know, in movies and in works of art and in literature, there's all types of images of what heaven is like. And we all have, you know, some of those images in our own minds, and, you know, the clouds and the angels with harps and so on and so forth. No one knows what exactly heaven is like. Some of the images from scripture that is used is that it is life, it is light, is peace, it's like a wedding feast, it's like the wine of the kingdom, it's the Father's house, the heavenly Jerusalem, paradise. So those are all just descriptive images of what heaven may be like. The church calls this contemplation of God in his heavenly glory the beatific vision, when we are there face to face with God. It is the beatific vision. The final, so that was about heaven. Now we're talking about another state of being after life called purgatory. So what is purgatory? All who die in God's grace and friendship, but still imperfectly purified, are indeed assured of their eternal salvation. But after death, they undergo purification so as to achieve the holiness necessary to enter the joy of heaven. So for most of us, myself included, you know, if we ask ourselves the question, have I totally and completely given myself over to God and to Christ? Do I have all sin? As you know, there is no sin in my heart, in my life, that hasn't been forgiven. You know, answer for myself and for most of us is no. I'm not perfectly purified. I'm still holding something back from God, and so purgatory is the experience of having that purged from our life. We are, in most part, united with God, but not perfectly purified in God. So it's purgatory is the experience of having that purified. The final purification of the elect is entirely different from punishment of the damned. So otherwise, purgatory is very different from those who will not be with God in heaven because they have turned against God and will forever be not united with God, and thus in hell. The councils of Florence and Trent. Florence, I think it was around, a council was around 1200s. Trent was in the 1500s that those councils formulated this doctrine on purgatory. St. Gregory the Great, who was in, I think, the 500s, 600s AD, said, sin against the Holy Spirit is not forgivable in this life or the next. The reason why I bring that up is not talking about the sin against the Holy Spirit, but rather the last part of the statement, saying that it's not is not forgivable in this life or the next. So he's indicating that there are sins that are forgiven in the next life. So it isn't just our physical life, but after we die, we have a possibility of sins being forgiven. Just an aside, this was one of the questions that was posed in the advertisement of this session, just talking about suicide. First of all, for a sin to be a mortal sin that separates us totally from God, we have to have the knowledge that it is a sin. The sin itself must be a grave sin. And thirdly, we have to have the freedom to still freely choose that sin. In most cases of suicide, you know, they might know the first and second, that it's a serious sin, that it's a grave sin. But most people that end up dying by suicide really do not have the freedom. Because of either mental illness or whatever situation's going on in their life, they aren't thinking clearly at that point. And so their freedom to choose suicide in choosing it because they want it is really not present there. So most cases, suicide is not a mortal sin by that person because they don't have that freedom to choose, and they can receive forgiveness after death. In 2 Maccabees, this is a passage pointing towards purgatory situation. Like I said earlier, Maccabees was in the 170s, 180s AD, they were revolting against the Greeks, and they were in a battle. And some of the Jewish soldiers died. And when they went to examine the bodies of those Jewish soldiers, some of them had amulets on them that represented foreign gods. And so that was, you know, a sin against the commandment, you shall have, you know, only Lord your God as your God alone. So Judas Maccabees, who was the leader of the group, made atonement for the dead that they might be delivered from this sin against the first commandment. So this is the passage. Judas rallied his army and went to the city of Adullam. As the week was ending, they purified themselves according to custom and kept the Sabbath there. On the following day, since the task had now become urgent, Judas and his men went to gather up the bodies of the slain and bury them with their kinsmen in their ancestral tombs. But under the tunic of each of the dead, they found amulets sacred to the idols of Jamnia, which the law forbids the Jews to wear. So it was clear to all that this is why these men had been slain. They all therefore praised the ways of the Lord, the just judge who brings to light the things that are hidden. Turning to supplication, they prayed that the sinful deed might be fully blotted out. The noble Judas warned the soldiers to keep themselves free from sin, for they had seen with their own eyes what had happened because of the sin of those who had fallen. He then took up a collection among his soldiers, amounting to 2,000 silver drachmas, which he sent to Jerusalem to provide for expiatory sacrifice. In doing this, he acted in a very excellent and noble way, inasmuch as he had the resurrection of the dead in view. For if he were not expecting the fallen to rise again, it would have been useless and foolish to pray for them in death. But if he did this in view of the splendid reward that awaits those who have gone to rest in godliness, it was a holy and pious thought. Thus he made atonement of the dead that they might be free from sin. So this is an example of the praying for those who have died and die in a state in which they had committed sin, and that prayer would help them be released from sin. In the 1300s, there's an author by the name of Dante who wrote something called the Divine Comedy. It was a three-part book. The first part was Inferno, describing hell according to his vision. Second was Purgatorio, describing purgatory. And the third was Paradiso, describing paradise, heaven. The interesting thing, so they, keep in mind, this is just the images of an author, but in his Inferno, he described hell as having various circles going deeper and deeper down. And each of the circles of hell dealt with people that had done a particular sin, you know, so whether it be thievery or adultery or murder, stuff like that. Each of the circles of hell dealt with people that committed that particular sin, and the people who were being punished for their sin, and they had no hope in hell because they knew that they would be there forever. The interesting thing is that in the second book then, Purgatorio, he describes circles of purgatory going up, and the circles of purgatory were the same circles as the circles of hell for the various different sins. But everyone was bearing their punishment with a smile. They were joyful because they knew the once they were cleansed of this sin, what awaited them? What awaited them was heaven. So they were joyful in going through that purging of their sin because they knew eventually they would be with God in heaven. What is the actual experience of purgatory like? We don't know. Just like we don't know exactly what hell's like, we don't know exactly what heaven's like, we don't know exactly what purgatory is like. But it's more about the experience of what we are going to be going through. The experience of the purging, purifying us of our sin. It could be an instantaneous act. It could be over time. We don't know. The theology points to that the experience itself of being purged of our sin. Sin has a double consequence. So grave sin deprives us of communion with God and therefore makes us incapable of eternal life without first receiving forgiveness. So that's one consequence of sin. So we need to seek out forgiveness for our grave sin. And second consequence is every sin entails an unhealthy attachment to creatures which must be purified either here on earth or after death in the state called purgatory. This purification frees us from what is called temporal punishment of sin. And we'll come back to that in just a little bit. Forgiveness of sin and restoration of communion with God entail the remission of the internal punishment. So when we are forgiven of sin, that eternal punishment is removed. But there are still consequences unto that sin. So the temporal punishment of sin still remains. It's not a kind of vengeance God giving us, but rather it's a call for us to have conversion in our life. Strive by works of mercy and charity, as well as by prayer and various practices, penance, to put off the old person and to put on Christ, the new person. So it's a call, that temporal punishment is a call to help us have conversion of heart. The church was given the keys of this gift of repentance and dealing with temporal punishment via the keys. After the resurrection, Jesus sent apostles to so that repentance and forgiveness of sin should be preached in his name to all nations. This, of course, is referred to as the keys of the kingdom. There's no offense that cannot be forgiven, provided that repentance of the person is honest. priests have received, according St. John Chrysostom said, priests have received from God a power that he has given neither to angels nor to archangels. God above confirms what priests do here below. What are indulgences? They are a remission of temporal punishment due to sin. So that second consequence of sin, indulgences deal with the temporal punishment. The church, as the minister of reconciliation that Christ gave to his apostles, applies such indulgences. They are either partial or plenary. Partial removal of the temporal punishment, or plenary is a total removal of a temporal punishment. And it can apply to, an indulgence can be applied either to yourself or to the dead, those who have died. So again, just a review here, that double consequence of sin, eternal punishment, deprives communion with God either fully or partially, and so we need to receive forgiveness for that. And then the second part is temporal punishment. That remains even after forgiveness, and works of charity need to come about to overcome that temporal punishment. Remission before God of the temporal punishment due to sin, whose guilt has already been forgiven. So, the sin has been forgiven. Now the working on the temporal punishment due to sin. Just give a legal example in our world. So imagine somebody commits murder. They can be forgiven of that crime of murder. But even though they are forgiven, it doesn't mean that the temporal punishment, the legal punishment, is going to be wiped away. So they still have to serve the legal punishment. And the same thing is with our sin before God. We might be forgiven, but we still have the punishment, temporal punishment, for which we must pay. I'm going to just deal with not the partial indulgence, but the plenary indulgence process. There are different times where a plenary indulgence might be offered. So just thinking this this past year at the Chrism Mass, the bishop offers a plenary indulgence. Many times at ordinations, they'll offer a plenary indulgence for those who have participated in the ordination. This past spring, Pope Francis offered a couple different plenary indulgences dealing with the coronavirus for both the victims of the disease and for those working in healthcare, with those taking care of those who are sick. So how does the plenary indulgence happen? First of all, it must be announced by, granted by a bishop or more offering that indulgence. And upon, and then there would be usually some type of charitable work or prayer, praying the aspiration or prayer for which the indulgence is granted. So like at the Chrism Mass, there was a particular prayer that all were asked to pray at that point. So that was need to do that. And then on the individual level, must have a complete and wholehearted detachment from all sin. So must be consciously desiring to be detached from sin. And then the individual needs to make a valid sacramental confession, and that can happen either before the indulgence happens or soon after the indulgence. And then receive Holy Communion in the state of grace. And lastly, pray for the intentions of the Pope, just praying for whatever his intentions are. You don't need to know what those intentions are, but just praying that God grant the intentions of the Pope. Doing all those things, then a person receives that plenary indulgence. indulgences and how that works with the communion of saints. We believe that we are united with the saints in the mystical body. The body of Christ is not just those living now here on earth. It includes those that are in heaven with God. It includes the communion of saints, also includes the angels and archangels. All of them are part of the mystical body of Christ. And in this mystical body, the holiness of one profits another. So we don't just earn holiness for our own individual self, and nor do the saints just earn for their individual self. All of that is shared together in the communion of saints. So recourse to saints lets the contrite sinner be promptly purified. This exchange is called the church's treasury. It is not just the good done, but also added into that treasury is the infinite amount earned by Christ through his death and resurrection. So that church's treasury is open for all the faithful to receive from. The treasury includes prayer and good works of Mary, the saints, and all who follow in the footsteps of God, of the Lord. The treasury includes the masses offered for the deceased. You know, each mass, we have a mass intention most of the time for someone who is deceased. That is adding to the church's treasury, not just for that person, but for all of God's faithful. Through indulgences, the church intervenes in favor of the individual and opens for them the treasury of the merits of Christ and the saints. Help the faithful departed. We help the faithful departed by obtaining indulgences for them so that they might be purged of anything that keeps them resisting from sin. So we went through heaven, went through purgatory, and now hell. We cannot be united with God unless we freely choose to love him. But we cannot love him if we sin gravely against him and our neighbors. To die in mortal sins without repenting means remaining separated from him forever by our own free choice. So the chief punishment of hell, no matter what the descriptive things might be out there in literature and movies and stuff, the chief thing about hell is that we are eternally separated from God, that we will not see God face to face. So it is our responsibility to seek conversion, to want to be with God, to choose that narrow gate. God predestines no one to go to hell. It is our own willful turning away from God. You know, one of the Christian, our Protestant denominations that started in the 1500s was Calvinism, and John Calvin purported a belief in predestination, that God not only knew if a person would go to heaven or hell, but that God predestined, chose this person is going to heaven, this person is going to hell. We as Catholics do not believe that. We have freedom to be able to choose God, to have conversion in our life. God does not, from the beginning of our life, choose if we are going to go to heaven or hell. That freedom is ours. And that predestination theology can have, you know, real world effects. So church in Dutch Reformed Church was a Calvinistic theology. And the Dutch ended up settling South Africa. And if you know the society in South Africa for many years, the blacks or the coloreds were those that were mixed race. The leaders following their Dutch Reform theology, believed that all of them were predestined for hell, that they would not be saved. So therefore, that led to the behavior on how they treated the blacks and the colored. They treated them as subhumans, we had apartheid and stuff because they just, they believed that this person is going to hell. Why do we need to treat them as a real human person? So it can have real effects on that theology, but Catholic Church does not believe in predestination, that God gives all of us the freedom of having conversion, freedom to choose God. At the last judgment, all will be resurrected, the just and the unjust, and they will proceed to the last judgment. When the voice of Christ comes, he gathers all the nations, separating them into goats and sheep. In the presence of Christ, the truth of each man's relationship with God will be laid bare. When is this going to happen? Only the Father knows the timing. So don't invest any time or energy in anyone that is going to tell you exactly when the end of time is coming. No one knows. Only the Father knows. The last judgment will reveal that God's justice triumphs over all the injustices committed by his creatures. The message of the last judgment calls us to that conversion. And lastly, the hope of the new life, new heaven, and a new earth. After universal judgment, the righteous will reign with Christ. The universe itself will be renewed. The renewed universe in Scripture is called a new heaven and the new earth. And that's the end of our presentation. Why don't we thank you for watching. Hope you are able to, was hopefully able to help you inform on some of the teaching of the church's teaching on afterlife and salvation. Let us close with prayer. Eternal life grant unto them, O Lord, and let perpetual light shine upon them. May they rest in peace. Amen. May their souls and souls of all the faithful departed rest in peace. Amen. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. And now I have to figure out how to end this. Oh, there we go.